To answer the question proposed in the title, I would say no, at least not for me. There, video over. When I ask if Kingdom Hearts 3 ruined itself, I'm more so asking, did it maybe sabotage itself during the infamously way too long pre-release period? Can we maybe trace a lot of dissatisfaction with the game back to how it was marketed over what was essentially a 5.5 year period? To answer those questions, we might be veering towards something closer to a yes, but those aren't very algorithm-friendly titles. And before we really get started on this big ol' opinion piece here, I have to issue all of the usual blanket statements and clarifications in an attempt to convince people to be, like, 20% less mean to me. I'm someone who really enjoyed KH3 more than the second game, and it's alright if you think the opposite, we can still hold hands, from a distance preferably. I should also say I was not fully tapped into the pre-release hype, mostly because a lot of it was... a lot. So I actually didn't watch all of the trailers and stay up to date with every little thing about the game before it came out. And I'm retroactively really glad I didn't, and that's sort of my hypothesis for the video, though there's no real way to prove anything. But I'm positing that the more pre-release material you consumed, the more 10-minute hype-mongering news videos you watched, and the longer you let these phantasmical ideas swirl around in your head, the more likely it is that you ended up feeling underwhelmed by the actual product. Again, just to be crystal clear, there are definitely people out there who watched zero trailers and found the game to be disappointing, just as there are probably people who ate up every single thing before release day and enjoyed the game even more than I did. But there's just an idea I have, a real Notre Damean hunch that this game activated the Aerogun form change and promptly shot itself in the foot before it even arrived at the starting line. I can only assume from my own anecdotal evidence about my own experience that my feelings and reactions to the game would have been different depending on how much I knew about it beforehand, and that's like the foundational material for the video. Don't take any of it as the gospel truth. It's also not a novel concept I'm suggesting here that KH3 went overboard with the trailers, but I wanted to take an especially close look at the run-up to January 25th, 2019, and basically complain for a little bit, if that's alright with you. So, when I started out with this project, I was already annoyed by how much the trailers for Kingdom Hearts 3 had shown, and naturally, to research and prepare, I watched every single trailer I could find. On the other side of nearly 1 hour of footage, I emerged somehow angrier. I had obviously been aware that certain things were shown, but seeing it for myself had me asking why more than 3 years after the fact. To start, here's all the trailers, or promotional video things, or commercials, or whatever you want to call them. There's a lot here for sure, but bear in mind we've got a fair bit of repeat material here, and this is also across nearly a 6 year period. The quantity doesn't really bother me. I'll take a basic gameplay showcase with a couple of flashy new things thrown in once a month. I don't really care. It's the characters and environments and story elements being shown off that really brings my potions to a boil, so to speak. Honestly, everything up to this point is pretty much fine in my book. Once we hit 2018, though, we really start going off the rails. And I understand the desire to drum up attention and hype by throwing everything in the kitchen sink into these trailers, but it gets to be a bit overkill and, for me, stunts the actual experience when you get your hands on the game. Not to mention, I find it kind of counterintuitive, and we'll get to that later. Let's talk about this chunk of trailers from 2013 to 2017. It all kicked off with that scene of Sora picking up the Master's Defender back at E3 2013. It's more of a teaser than anything else, but it did its job at tricking us into thinking the game was anywhere close to coming out. I'm kidding, of course, but I did think I'd be playing it by the end of high school instead of by the end of college, and that depresses me every single time I say it. In the following years, we get a lot of Olympus stuff with a ton of focus on the Rock Titan boss fight. Other major stories here include the announcements of worlds inspired by Tangled and Big Hero 6, some Twilight Town Demon Tower footage, a lot of Ericus and young Xehanort, and the last major thing we get in 2017 is the reveal of the toy box. There's other stuff strewn about those years as well, obviously, but those are the headlines. Now, as I mentioned, I start to take issue with things once we get that Monsters, Inc. trailer in 2018. And not at all because of Monsters, Inc. itself. In fact, as much as I'd ideally love to not know which Disney worlds would appear in a game, even I can get behind it being the best move on a marketing level to forecast every single one before release day. This is, for the record, something the series has always done since the first game in 2002. My problems arise from how, starting from this trailer and moving forward, they just start showing off way too much KH original stuff for my liking. We get Marluxia in Kingdom of Corona, we get Vanitas here in Monstropolis, we get Larxene in Arendelle, Luxord in the Caribbean, Replicu on Destiny Islands, and don't even get me started on the final battle trailer. Some of you might be saying, we pretty much knew these characters would be back, but doesn't it kind of miss the point when you get confirmation of their return in a trailer? This isn't Smash Bros. DLC, it's a story-based game delivering on decade-long promises that you get to experience for the first time, one time. I understand the allure of getting social media buzz when they show off Larxene or Marluxia. I get that fans are gonna eat that shit up and talk about it constantly and keep the game and the company in people's mouths for weeks, but I just can't help but view it as short-term gratification at the expense of the actual experience with the game itself. And I'll even give them one or two of these reveals. Again, ideally I'd want everything to be a surprise, but if you want some social media heat in the lead-up to release, then sure, show off some Marluxia scenes. But they gave us, like, everything. Besides Yzora and the Foretellers, you know, characters that appear in, like, secret scenes or in-game commercials for a few seconds, the trailer showed us every single original character that would end up appearing in the game. I mean, is the hype really worth it, and does it not just give people months and months to cook up these crazy and unrealistic theories about how this is all gonna play out? If you just toss them into the pool, they just deal with the temperature in the moment, but you gave them the frog in boiling water treatment and it ended up frying their brains. Mixed up my body of water metaphors a bit there, but I think you understand. I think this is all most painfully evident with the anti-Aqua of it all, which I'm convinced was really just factory made for a trailer. It was this shocking moment presented with so much gravity behind it, and for what? For people to speculate and be excited for a few weeks, and then nobody ever cared about it again because it was deliberately misleading and the game didn't really go anywhere with it. I mean, they showed us the boss battle itself in a trailer soon after. You let people think there was this huge plot point being teased, that Xehanort was involved somehow, that it was gonna play a major part in the story, and it was never any of that stuff. It was trailer bait. And then you just showed us that Sora would just resolve it by beating the shit out of her anyway, so what was even the point? It could have just been a fun, one-off moment in the game, which is basically what I view it as when divorced from the trailers, but with the trailers in mind, people's expectations snowballed until the snowball melted into, well, a puddle of Aqua. And what really boggles my mind about all of this is that you can ask the question, who is this for? And the answer is obvious. It's for fans of the series. It's for fans who know who Aqua is. AKA, it's for people who were always going to buy Kingdom Hearts fucking 3 no matter what you show. You're not selling this game to newcomers by showing Aqua in the Dark World or shots of Shion in the Keyblade Graveyard. You're not even selling it to casual fans who only played the numbered titles and then dropped off because they don't know or care who these people are. You sell this game to casuals and newcomers by showing off a bunch of Disney shit, by throwing Queen Elsa at them at mock speed, by showing off Sora doing some crazy form changes, and reminding them of the basic formula that they fell in love with in 2002 or 6. The only people who care about these characters in black coats, or possibly Norded Guardians, are people who are already on the hook, and you're only diluting these in-game moments for them and whipping up rabid, wild speculation that's never going to amount to what people are hoping for. Maybe you have fond memories of the pre-release hype for KH3. I really don't. I like seeing trailers and thinking about what things could mean. I've done it before on this channel, and I'm sure I'll do it again. But I also understand expectation management and the more cynical reality of marketing, and I apologize for going out on a limb and saying that I don't know if a lot of fans do. Not just for Kingdom Hearts, but just like media in general. But I don't really blame fans for letting their imagination run wild or feeling underwhelmed by the game, because Square did it to themselves. And at the end of the day, they're fine. The game sold well, it was more or less well received by critics, and the series shows no signs of stopping. It's the hardcore fans themselves, the people these juicy trailer moments were for, the ones making YouTube videos and writing long forum posts, who are stuck dealing with the discourse. A big chunk of people the trailers were trying to cater to ended up lashing out the hardest, which is really kind of tragic when you think about it. Again, we're talking in generalities and opinions here. In no universe am I saying that any critique of KH3 can be dismissed because there were too many trailers. There are issues with the game, there are things that could have been done better. And I'm sure some of you out there had a ton of fun in the lead up to KH3, watched all the trailers, and still really enjoyed the game because you're good at that aforementioned expectation management. I'm just someone who always values how I feel about the product itself in the moment more than any peripheral stuff that comes before or after. I like to imagine a universe where I played Kingdom Hearts 3 and had no idea who the 13 Darknesses were before going into it. This is like one of my most major bones to pick, and maybe I'm too fixated on it. For me, the big speculative theory conversation after beating Dream Drop Distance was, who are the 13 vessels? Some folks may hear that and think it's a boring or overrated thing to be so concerned with, that it was always going to be a bunch of familiar faces, and I'll grant you that I was fairly certain it'd be characters we already knew, but we still had such a huge pool of characters to take from. This is why I don't really take issue with any of those pre-2018 trailers, because most of the original characters we see besides the main protagonists are members of the 13 who we already knew about. We knew about Master and Young Xehanort and Ansem, Xemnas, Zigbar, and Saix. But when they just show us Marluxia or Vanitas or Luxord wearing the black coats in these trailers, that kinda takes the wind out of my sails. I don't know if they're all people I would have picked to be in the new 13. And to get these types of reveals in a trailer for a fleeting moment of hype months before the game comes out, instead of being blindsided in the moment, it's just kind of a shame if you ask me. To their credit, the trailers did at least include what you might call red herrings of Demix and Vexen, who ended up being backups or benched members, but even they were never featured as prominently as any of the real members of the true organization. Again, for the people who would actually care about any of these reveals, they already had a trailer that was concerned with the original characters and setting up the story. It was called Kingdom Hearts Dream Drop Distance in 2012. People who skipped entries or disregarded the non-numbered titles as insulated side games are not gonna see Vanitas or Rienzo and go, "Oh man, I've gotta get my hands on this." So I just don't know what it accomplishes beyond the previously mentioned buzz generation, and if that's it, then it wasn't worth it, at least in my book. Of course, you could say this entire conundrum is pretty easily avoided by just not watching any trailers, but I think that's a bit willfully naive. Not even for me, who kind of needs to be at least somewhat aware of what's going on with current events in the series, but for like anyone who would consider themselves a moderate to hardcore fan of the games. I mean, I did start avoiding trailers after a certain point, and stuff still slips through the cracks. And this was before I had the channel, I was just making the mistake of being, you know, a human person on the internet. I might have dared to follow a KH account on Twitter or ventured over to the Kingdom Hearts subreddit, and when I wasn't greeted with a deluge of Donald healing memes or screenshots of platinum trophies, I might have found out that XYZ is gonna be in the game. XYZ is a placeholder example and not the name of a real Kingdom Hearts character, just for the record. It does not stand for Kai Young Zubrunor, at least as far as I'm aware. Just thought I'd clarify for any casuals who made it this far into something that only a dedicated fan of the series would care to watch. And before moving off of KH3, and yeah, believe it or not, there's more, I just want to do a quickish lightning round of everything we saw in promotional videos in 2018 and 2019, and you can be the judge of whether or not too much was shown. And I want to know, what was your experience with the pre-release period like? How many of these did you watch, and how did you feel about the game? Maybe I'm overreacting or being too harsh in hindsight. If I am, you can call me a big dumb baby, and I won't even be mad because it means that you're at least listening to me, and I just want to be heard. But do let me know, because I'm genuinely curious, and if I wasn't, I would call this like a question of the video so I could get that juicy engagement. And I'm just assuming, for the sake of this exercise, that whenever something new shows up in these trailers, it's the first time most people are meant to know about it. I'm looking at it from the perspective of a fan who's only going to consume each trailer that Square puts out, not factoring in trawling around for tweets or interviews or leaks, just purely stuff that's shown off in the most easily accessible and popular format.
Lightning!
So, D23 Japan 2018, it's the Monsters, Inc. trailer. We've got Marluxia and Kingdom of Omicron and the King of Toys, the aerial summon, some form changes, and Vanitas detecting Ventus inside Sora right before the Yidus Vanitas scene. The Don't Think Twice trailer, which is mostly older footage with Don't Think Twice playing, but also Riku and Michael in the Dark World with the Broken Way to Dawn and Riku talking about the Other Me. The Classic Kingdom trailer, with SDG and HPO looking at the CK on the GP and TT, no RCT from RP, that's no real complaints there from regular Pat. The Frozen trailer, obviously featuring Arendelle, including the Marshmallow Battle, the Shield sliding sequence, and we get a lot of gameplay stuff here with the Blizzard Claws transformation, both the Simba and Ralph summons, and the River Rapids attraction. Some Gummy Ship and Giga stuff in there, capped off with two big ones, Larxene's appearance, and infamously the Aqua Got Norded moment, shout out to ProZD. They also make sure to show Larxene asking if Elsa will choose light or darkness, igniting so much discussion before they just do the movie plot anyway, thanks so much for that. The E3 2018 Showcase trailer, which is a fair amount of older stuff, sprinkled with the Magic Carousel attraction, Little Chef, Zigbar and Olympus, HPO running from the Demon Tower, some Ienzo chit-chat, and very briefly Lee and Kyrie in the Secret Forest. To be honest, I'm totally fine with this one. The Pirates trailer, which shows off the Caribbean, everything from Davy Jones' locker to the Raging Vulture, ship combat, underwater stuff, etc, etc. Luxord shows up, Vanitas talks about Unversed a bit, Larxene drops the new Seven Lights, Ansem and Xemnas choreograph their cool simultaneous line, some more Zigbar and Olympus, Lee and Kyrie with her new look, and Riku and Replicu on Destiny Islands because sure, fuck it. Next is the Tokyo Game Show 2018 Big Hero 6 stuff, with SDG in San Francisco, you get some Randall, some Reapers, some Nano Gears, some shit talk from Vanitas, and then, hey, let's just get everything, please. Give us the Dark Baymax and Dark Cubes battle, Flash Tracer, that cool HPO hallucination on the bridge, the Kraken, the Skull Fight with the Marshmallow Limit, Ansem and Zigbar in Twilight Town, Vexen and Demix in Radiant Garden, Sora and Dark Riku in San Fran, Vanitas and Ven in Land of Departure. Demix with a vessel, Lee and Saix on the clock tower, Ansem the clown and Ienzo in the lab, just fuck it, little bit of Terranort, little bit of Vanitas trying to stab Aqua, Sora and Ven's dive to the heart, why not have Roxas unhood with Oblivion in hand, why not? Wouldn't want you to feel that moment in full force a couple months from now, god forbid, let's just ease you into it. Thankfully by this point in real time, I'm trying my best to ignore all of this because now we're really in the shit. Oh, okay, thank God. It's just a Winnie the Pooh trailer. This was the safest bet anyway. It's like the middle space on the numbered KH game bingo card. Just show off the Candy Crush minigame and definitely not Sora and Chirithi in the final world, the big heartless nobody unverse mob that people would have hated to discover the first time in the moment. Not Terranort versus the Lingering Will, since people would have just predicted that anyway. And thankfully, they also did not show off one of my favorite gameplay segments where you fly around the most mysterious KH location since Hollow Bastion and collect a bunch of Phantom Soras. Would have hated if they did any of that. And also, hey loser. Nothing huge in the next few, I guess because they were considerate enough to predict that I'd be very close to having an aneurysm 3 years later. Just a movie trailer voiceover guy, some Supreme Smasher and Randall, some Marshmallow, the 13 Darknesses in the Keyblade Graveyard, I can work with that. We get the opening movie trailer a bit later, which, fine, nothing revelatory there. And then they said, wait, the game is almost out. We can't just release the game without a full forecast. Our fans are Tennessee fainting goats. They might pass out while playing the game if they don't know exactly what's coming. Introducing the final battle trailer. Hey, what's even left? Whatever's left, scrape it off the counter and into the trailer bowl. Have we shown off literally every boss yet? Everything but the big dinosaur guy in San Francisco, sir. Okay, we'll save that one for the real deal, but dump everything else in the bowl. Grim Guardianess, Lump of Horror, Lightning Angler, Davy Jones, toss it all in. I want them to know exactly what they'll be up against. Give them some prep time. Oh, and I know the summons could be like the one morsel of Disney joy left to discover in the game, but fuck it, we already showed off all the other ones, so here's Stitch. Also, remember all of those moments that almost killed that asshole on YouTube 3 years from now? Let's show them again, but like, more of it? I can actually hear him screaming why, his nerdy cries are echoing into the past. Just for you, YouTube asshole, you may have Xemnas Lasering Axel, that's a why. Terranort chaining up Sora Venon Aqua, big ol' why just for you. The Replicanorth in Scala Ad Kylum, that's what it's called, by the way. Oh, what a delicious why that was. I hope you don't mind the emotional climax of the game, what with the whole everyone getting swept up by the demon tide and Sora screaming bloody murder. I don't want you to hurt your thumbs or wallet actually playing the game when you can just get it here for free. Here's Zetaflare, by the way, I know you love that. I skimmed through this one, by the way, for the sake of time, but there's still more. I cannot express how glad I am that by this point I was so fatigued by the KH3 pre-release culture and missed almost all of this in the real time. But I'm speaking for the version of me in another world line who did watch this and didn't get to marvel at Scala or the final world or perk up when Sora reunited with Stitch in-game or literally yell at the screen and feel like a kid again when Replicu turns up. That's the last trailer that gives away anything substantial, and it just makes me wonder, can anyone really be surprised about how many people reacted to the game negatively, especially when it comes to the story and pacing conversation? I've already made my thoughts known on how KH3's pacing and Disney integration is handled, and I always thought people judged the game so harshly on especially these two categories, but I sincerely am a lot more sympathetic to that perspective now, having watched all of these trailers. I totally get why it might feel like nothing interesting or cool happens for a lot of the game, a point I normally vehemently disagree with, when a lot of the cool and interesting stuff is characters and locations that you saw 8 months ago. I am once again making it painfully clear that I don't think you're wrong if you're currently typing up a comment that begins with actually, I just have to think that for some folks, these marketing decisions had a considerable and maybe even subconscious impact on how they received the game. I want to point out one of the chronologically last pre-release promotional videos for KH3 that I could find, titled the Special Version Commercial. I love this. I don't care if it's corny or if it doesn't get people talking, I still think you can sell the game on something like this. I mean, it can't do all of the heavy lifting, obviously, but these are basically like testimonials from people who grew up with the series. If you're snagging the younger generation with the new Disney stuff, you can pull back in those wayward old heads by hitting them with nostalgia, by reminding them of the magic of the series. Don't rely on the specifics, rely on the feeling. Don't give out every piece of the puzzle, just tell them what a puzzle is, remind them how much fun they had the last time they did a puzzle. Maybe not that puzzle. You, of course, still need to show new stuff, but it can just be foundational, and I think you can get a lot of mileage out of this celebratory, sort of inspiring energy. I think you can accomplish so much through just being like, hey, remember Kingdom Hearts 1 and 2? Okay, so that again, except you're old now and you're gonna cry. Here's Sora airstepping and also Buzz Lightyear. That's all you need to do. Future Pat here, at the editing chair, which is the same chair that I use to do everything else. Here's the big dinosaur guy. I thought that they maybe left him out. This was after the final battle trailer, but nope, he's here too, so now you know every single goddamn boss in the game. Back to old Pat. That's all you need to do. I promise people still would have talked about the game. They talked about it from 2005 to 2012 when they thought it was going to be the next entry they played, when there was literally nothing about the game out there. So, yeah, I don't know, I guess they really just fumbled the ball with this one. Except, wait, oh, they've always been like this. Right now, in 2022, Kingdom Hearts 3 is the most recent major release. I love Melody of Memory, but you know, different tiers here. The game came out in 2019, 7 years after the last full-length game, Dream Drop Distance. So by 2019, and especially by now, we're pretty far removed from that era being our last major pre-release period, as painful as it is to think about 2012 being that long ago. And if I'm being honest, I just didn't have the awareness or interest in keeping up with pre-release news like I do nowadays. I have no real substantial memories of trailers for any of the other games besides commercials for 1 and COM, and once again, I'm glad I was somewhat disconnected because KH3 is just the worst example of a long-established trend. I'm fixated on KH3 because it's still sorta recent, and it was preceded by one of the most infamously long pre-release periods in gaming history. And I think it was always gonna be extra scrutinized regardless of what it did just because of that wait. But taking a look at Dream Drop Distance, a game that released 2 years after the last major entry, you get stuff like the E3 2012 trailer, or the nearly 10-minute special trailer, with moments like Sora in the World That Never Was talking to Zigbar, or Riku in the Round Room with Master Xehanort. Like, quit showing off the last world, please? Now, I still don't think this is as egregious as KH3, mostly due to how that game is set up. You're pretty much given a synopsis at the end of Dream Drop, like a basic blueprint of what's gonna happen next, which is something you don't really get in the other games. You get teasers of what's to come, like anytime Sora gets a letter, but you don't get to see the letter laying out the villain's plan. So when you already get the basic outline from Dream Drop, and then so many little details and key moments from the trailers, it feels like you've gotten so much of the game beforehand. So I think almost all of the other games can more excusably get away with showing stuff off, but if I had it my way, I don't even think I want to see Lee waking up, or Ansem and Xemnas messing with Sora and Riku, which is stuff they had even in the earliest 2011 teasers. We go a little further back to Birth by Sleep with the Simple and Clean launch trailer, which does a pretty good job for like the first three quarters before throwing everything out the window. I'm obviously not going to take issue with any shots from the final Keyblade Graveyard battle, since this game is in the unique position of that sequence having been shown to us in KH2. Most of the early part of the trailer is clips like that, a bunch of Disney stuff, and some expository plot teases from the new original characters. Again, since the last game didn't like set up the whole story structure of BBS, I don't mind having these things here to hook fans. You've got to show some original and compelling stuff. But then things just start to get unnecessary and buzz-killing when partway through we get scenes of Terra meeting Riku or Aqua meeting Kairi. I think back to my BBS world rankings where I gushed about Radiant Garden because it featured so many cameos of past characters, and literally none of them would have been a surprise had I known about this trailer. My first trips to Radiant Garden and BBS are like some of my favorite memories with the series, and this trailer gives you all of the fun parts, every single organization member that appears. If that wasn't enough, they, for whatever reason, felt compelled to show off some of the mysterious figure fight, which really goes a long way in neutering the secrecy part of a secret boss. And then they felt the need to show off a bunch of endgame shit that isn't the final battle sequence, including the clear as day apocalypse in the Land of Departure, Aqua at Castle Oblivion, the very beginning of the Vanitas face reveal, and Aqua in the Realm of Darkness. They're literally playing Ansem the Wise's blank point speech over the final part of the trailer. And again, I'm asking why. You don't have to do this. You were doing so well teasing the Vanitas thing, and then you just gave internet sleuths enough to figure out that he's just a limited My Chemical Romance edition of Sora. I mean, Aqua at Castle Oblivion, I lost my mind when that happened in the real time, whereas had I watched this, I would have had three campaigns to ponder how and why she'd end up there, because I would have known it was gonna happen. It's almost like they can't help themselves with these things, like it's a lack of confidence that people will want to play unless you give them the juiciest moments you have available. There is so obviously a happy medium you can strike, and they were pretty much doing it here until like 6 minutes into their 7-minute trailer. Plus, it's Birth by Sleep we're selling here. I have to think that the people most likely to buy this game are the ones invested in the series enough to feel robbed when these moments are forecasted. Sure, there are like 5 space aliens out there who started the series with BBS and maybe saw this trailer and those endgame moments meant nothing to them, but again, that's like the 5 people who owned a PSP and saw the Disney stuff and said, yeah, I'll bite. I reiterate again, the people who could care most about seeing these things are simultaneously the most adversely affected by seeing them. I could go through each game with a fine-tooth comb and pick out every instance of stuff like this, but I think you get my point. KH1, obviously, was at the most liberty to show stuff and had the fewest opportunities to ruin itself due to its more straightforward nature, but it did at least manage to avoid showing off, like, Sora stabbing himself or Ansem's true form in a launch trailer. But then you still get head-scratchers like the Riku campaign being spoiled by the Chain of Memories commercial, or showing off what looks like Ansem in a KH2 trailer. You know, Ansem who was killed on screen? Again, you and I will be here forever if I go through every game in the series and talk about things that I personally find a bit too revealing. And again, maybe I'm being overly sensitive to the information we're given in the pre-release period. But I guess my point here is that this sort of philosophy... Hey, Future Pat again. Wow, they actually did show him. Clearly, I did not go through all of these trailers as thoroughly as I thought. I just thought there's no way they actually showed Ansem, a character that you only see the true form of, like, in the last, I don't know, eighth of the game. But here he is. Not a huge deal, I guess, but I'm just correcting the record because I'm not going back and rewriting this whole goddamn script. But I guess my point here is that this sort of philosophy regarding promotional materials, at least as I perceive it, has been around for quite a while, and KH3 was unfortunately the biggest victim of this for a variety of reasons I have already listed. And to be honest, I don't think it's just a Kingdom Hearts thing, I think it's a Square thing. Without delving into their entire catalog, there are post-KH3 games that take a similar, equally baffling route when it comes to trailers. Like, there's a moment they show off in the final trailer for the FF7 remake that I literally don't even feel comfortable showing in this video. If you have any interest in playing the game, seriously don't watch this trailer, which thankfully you probably won't since it's 2022 and the game has been out for nearly 2 years. I'm saying even if you played the original, you still shouldn't watch it, because I played the original, saw this moment in-game, and am so glad I wasn't ready for it. My brain in that moment was contemplating what the fuck I had just seen and if the game was really going there. So, yeah, I don't know how this ends. I guess I ask Square Enix to stop it, please? Like, knock it off? I want my memories of your games to be of when I was playing them, not watching them weeks or months beforehand in a YouTube video. But also, maybe I'm an idiot and the multi-million dollar marketing machine dictates that these are the exact things you're supposed to do, whether it's stuff like this in video games or showing all the funniest bits in a trailer for a comedy. I don't know. What do you think? Hey, hope you enjoyed the video. Did you think I was gonna trash on the game? You knew me better than that, right? You knew I wasn't gonna be like, KH3 bad. I had my reasons. This was totally not supposed to come out on the 3-year anniversary of Kingdom Hearts 3. That was not the plan before I budgeted my time incorrectly, just so you know. Not a ton to report, just thank you as always for this. Oh, wait. Wait. I think there is something. I did, in fact, hit 100 patrons on Patreon, and as I said in that KH2 boss ranking video back on Christmas, we will be doing a watch-through of every single direct-to-DVD or VHS Disney movie, and I'll be doing my next major video on that. Now that this one's out of the way, I can move on to getting intoxicated and watching some bad children's movies. It'll probably look a good bit different than most of my videos on this channel, but I made a promise, and you all delivered, and I thank you all so much. Other than that, you know where I am. Twitch, Twitter, Discord, regularpat.com has all of those me-related things on it. Until next time, stay safe out there and take it easy.